Hi there, and welcome to The Daily Gardener, a podcast about gardening, botanical history, and literature. I'm your host, Jennifer Ebling, and today is September 24th. Can you believe it? Wow. Well, today in botanical history, we're going to celebrate a British spy and an American farmer, a social reformer and poet, and an American writer. We'll hear an excerpt from a book that was written by the beloved Canadian writer Lucy Maud Montgomery of Anne of Green Gables fame, one of my favorite authors. And we grow that garden library today with a very fun book about homestead life, from growing great produce to canning and preserving. And then we'll wrap things up with a look back at Minnie Height Moody's garden column from this day in 1980. She made herself a bouquet of weeds, and then she wrote about it. A woman after my own heart. And, you know, it reminds me, I've been walking Sunny. Whoops, there we go. You know, the old pet names come back to us. Sorry, Max, new habits. I've been walking Max in the woods around here. And today I had the pleasure of going to a park we've been to in the past. What I didn't realize is we went a little further down and then to the right. We usually go to the left. And then, what do you know? I discover that it connects to one of our other favorite parks. So it was like, boom, mind blown, totally crazy. But what I'm doing on these walks is, number one, of course, appreciating the different plants. And the sumac up here is starting to turn, and it is so beautiful. I love it when the sumac leaves are like Christmas. And I mean, they are the green, 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 and then the red, red, red. It is this strange thing that they do before they really put on the fall color. So I took a picture of the sumac. And then the other thing I'm doing, I feel like an old-time botanist here, but what I'm doing is I am starting to mentally map out where certain plants are growing, and also the types of pine cones that I'm seeing. And I found a spot today where there are really slender golden colored pine cones. They're about 2 to 3 inches long. They are wonderful. So I'm going to go back and harvest a few of those just for Christmas and for seasonal decor. And then I found another tree, a couple of trees actually, that were in the middle of nowhere. And these have the little bitty pine cones, like little tiny inch long pine cones. And you know, Pottery Barn will gather those things up and sell them for what, $25 or something like that. So you can put a few around some candles or something. So anyway, I want those for my porch for setting up for the holidays. So I'll go back before the snow falls and collect some of those in some bags, and I'll have fun doing that. The other thing I have a great deal of fun with right now with Max is finding walking sticks. And there's just something about walking a dog and having a walking stick. I have some walking sticks, so if you're wondering, yes, I do. I have professionally made walking sticks, and they're great. But every now and then, I love stumbling on just one from nature. And boy, are they interesting, aren't they? So that's what we did today. We got up this morning right away. We are in the time of year, at least here in Minnesota, where we can go from having a 90 degree day to the very next day, it's something completely different and usually a little bit dreadful. Today we had rain, stormy skies, wind like crazy, and cold. It was cold out. And so I went outside and I thought I was going to walk the dog, and I had to make a pit stop, turn around, come back, get a hat and mittens and all the stuff so we could stay outside a little bit longer. And then I was laughing because I talked to my daughter who's in college. She's about 30 minutes away, so not bad. But she said her professor had let them know that he wanted to have class outside today. And I started laughing. I said, well, that's because he's basing it on the weather from yesterday. And then about an hour after we talked, it started to rain. So I was thinking about her professor in that class and whether or not he actually decided to bring everybody back indoors. So anyway, I don't know what's on your agenda for this weekend, but one of the things that I plan on doing is putting together a little weed bouquet. I was inspired by reading this article that's going to be the Botanic Spark for today's show. It'll be at the end of today's show. Kind of made me chuckle. But also, as I've been on these walks with Max, I am seeing so many beautiful natural elements, so many wonderful fall flowering perennials and perennial weeds. Some of them, I don't even know what they are. I saw one today. It is the most delicate looking little flower. I'll take a picture and put it in the Facebook group. Maybe you guys can help me out with it. So anyway, I'm going to draw some inspiration from Mini Height Moody and put together a weed bouquet. That's on my agenda for the week. And I'm going to put it out on my porch. I like to use my porch as an outdoor room. It's still warm enough where I can get by with something like that. So I'll do that and just play around with it. So maybe that's something that you can do as well and enjoy a little bit of nature right outside your front door. All right, let's get to today's curated news. Today's curated news comes to us from Garden Therapy. This is another wonderful post by one of my favorite garden bloggers, Stephanie Rose. And you know, I was thinking the other day, I've got some folks like Stephanie where I have been reading and featuring articles that they've written for quite a long time. So I love that she's continuing to blog and continuing to stay active. So hats off to you, Stephanie, if you're listening. If not, I'll drop you a little line and say thank you personally, because I know it takes a lot of work to keep these things going. But what I thought I would share today is Stephanie has put together a complete fall garden checklist. And Stephanie is probably, I'm guessing, a lot like the blogger Jen McGinnis or Frau Zinni, because I know Jen does a great job of putting together monthly garden to-do checklists. And I remember one time speaking with her and she said, oh man, after what, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 years, you really get those monthly checklists down to a science. And so I'm betting that Stephanie has done the same thing here. Now, one thing I want to include about Stephanie's story is that if you head on over to her blog, it's at gardentherapy.ca. Stephanie is a really great role model because her love of plants is what she credits with healing her from a debilitating illness. So that's why she has the name of her blog, Garden Therapy, because she knows the power of garden therapy firsthand. So amen to that, sister. I hear you loud and clear there. And you know, that also reminds me really quickly that this morning I had a great chat with longtime listener Danny Perkins, and he and I started talking about aches and pains when you're out in the garden. And of course, as we get older, that's the challenge, right? Because garden work is hard. It's very rigorous. You know, my grandma used to say that if something was hurting, that was good because it meant that she was still alive. So there you go. All right. Well, anyway, I'm going to give you a quick little overview of Stephanie's complete fall garden checklist. Let me just pluck a few of her top tips out for you to kind of spark something in your mind so that as you're out in the garden that you're thinking about these. And then if you want to, you can check out her post. I'll share it in the Facebook group. So one of the things that she does, I know that I talked to Danny Perkins about this morning, is to leave the leaves, or to leave some of your garden plants, your foliage and your shrubs and whatnot. Just leave it alone. Let it be so that you have things like seed heads and stems for your wildlife. You got insects that are going to lay eggs in those stems. You have birds that are going to come by and eat those seed heads and enjoy them all winter long. So consider leaving the leaves. And this does not need to be an all or nothing proposition, by the way. In the front, I tend to do more of a cleanup. In the back, I definitely let it go. I let it be there for them. So you can do a mix and match. You don't have to go all whole hog on everything. Ah, and I see here that Stephanie's talking about allium seed heads. They're great. I mean, a lot of gardeners leave those up because even in the summer, they look great when they're dried, but they do look good all year long. You know, one of the things that Danny and I were talking about were the hydrangea. And, you know, he and I both like the hydrangea flowers when they kind of dry on the stem. This past year, I did an experiment where I left them up. I wanted to see just how long they could go. And you know, I had a hydrangea that they were putting on new blooms even while the old blooms were still on the plant. And at that point, I'm like, that's it, you gotta go. But I did leave them up for, well, almost, you know what, 6 months. And so quite impressive. And they were there and didn't hurt anything, didn't hurt the plant. You don't have to cut them off. But if you want that look, if you want them to be cleaned up, you can definitely take them off. So there you go. Mulching is something that's going to put a warm blanket kind of over your garden. It also freshens it up, makes it look really nice. Where you're at may depend on whether or not you're able to mulch. I know I've been talking to gardeners who are in spots where mulch is in kind of high demand and they're not having access to the amount of mulch that they're used to getting this time of year. So that's something to think about. The other thing is that you may want to get a bag or two more of mulch because we don't know what spring will be like. And maybe having a couple of bags of mulch handy might be a good thing in the spring. So you never know. I always like to go into the winter with about 10 or 12 bags of mulch behind the shed. And I know they're there. Then when I get going in the spring, before I want to put in my big order from Home Depot, I will have those and I can putz around with those before I get my big order. So just think about that. That's something else to think about. Stephanie talks about removing diseased material from your plants. That's a great idea. Planting spring bulbs. It's that time again. It's that time where we start talking about it. You know, if you're super sick of your garden or if you just had an area that wasn't doing well for you this year, you just felt like it was not as exciting as you wanted it to be, spring bulbs, that could be the answer that you're looking for. And if you want something that's foolproof, I would say go with daffodils. Daffodils over tulips because they are not bothered by the critters. The squirrels and the deer and whatnot leave them alone. Plus, they naturalize, so that's another great reason. Let's see here. Stephanie talks about saving seeds. I'm just scanning here really quickly. Oh, growing fall and winter vegetables. That's a great topic. Oh, another one here is preserving the ornamental garden. I like this. So here's what she's talking about. This is where you're going to go out and you're going to harvest some things from your pretty flowers, your pretty things in the garden, and you're going to use those to put together maybe wreaths or something else like that. Seed pods, by the way, are beautiful in Christmas containers. So consider that. You know, another thing that you might want to think about this time of year, I don't see it on the list here, but I always tell this to gardeners when we're talking about things that you can be doing right about now, is if you don't have a substantial planter on your property or planters that you're really invested in, now is often a great time to get them. I tell you what, at our local Hy-Vee, there are some drum planters. I mean, these guys are big. They're probably about 3 feet across. They're by some hoity-toity garden brand. I can't remember the name of it right now, but they are nice. They're very, very nice. These drum containers, I want to say they were $100 a piece. They were an investment. But right now, they are 50% off. And I have been watching them and watching them. You know, I just might approach the manager this week and say, would you go to 75% off? Because if he's willing to do that, I will buy all four of them. They are great. My point in saying this is that number one, if you don't have some type of substantial container on your property that you can invest in, that you can play in, then you are kind of missing out on an opportunity for you to use that as a focal point to do some seasonal design work in. You know, I have a 6 foot across cement container out in the front. It looks like a shell that's been placed on a cement stand. It's a huge container. Oh my gosh. But for me, that particular piece on our property, when I get that done for the holidays for fall, when I get it set for spring or when I do my summer set, that to me is when the season really begins. And I always feel so good when I get that done. And it kind of signals to everybody on the street, oh, it's time for fall, or oh, it's time for us to get out our Christmas decorations. And so if you don't have that type of container, maybe consider going out and getting that. You know, if you have not worked on your design skills, if you have not played around putting together containers, well, there you go. That's a little activity for you. And it's a way for you to stretch yourself, to grow and learn as a gardener, to go out and harvest a few things from your garden or from nature and put that together and just have fun with it. So anyway, it looks like Stephanie's got a great list here. I mean, it scrolls. You can just keep scrolling here. This fall garden checklist, it goes on for a while. But it, really nice comprehensive list. You might find a few things here that you've forgotten about. And you know, as I get to the bottom here, I see that she's got a printable. So yay. Yay for the printable. Very, very thoughtful. And it's also very pretty. Everything that Stephanie does on her website is always so, so visually appealing, which is another great thing. And I love her logo too, by the way. She's got a really great flower logo, and then her tagline is better living through plants. Love that. So in any case, if you want to check this out, I'm going to make it really easy for you. You can head on over to the Facebook group for the show. You will see it there. It's the Complete Fall Garden Checklist, and it's by Stephanie Rose over at Garden Therapy. Thank you, Stephanie. All right, it's time for today's botanical history. Here's botanical history for today, September 24th. Today in 1789 marked the death of Metcalf Bowler. He was the British-American merchant and politician. As a young man, Metcalf came to America with his father from England, and he successfully marketed a local apple known as the Rhode Island Greening Apple. It was part of his business. The apple later became the official state fruit of Rhode Island. A gentleman farmer, Metcalf himself was an avid horticulturist, and he was purported to have the most beautiful garden in the entire state. And it's worth noting that Metcalf was a successful merchant until the Revolutionary War, which actually ruined him financially. Now, in the 1920s, so over 100 years later, historians were stumbling on letters that were written by a British spy. Well, after some handwriting comparison, they, without a doubt, realized that that person was none other than Metcalf Bowler. Now, what I loved about this story is that as I was reading about it, I thought that his love of nature might have actually inspired his code name, which was Rusticus. Well, after the war, Metcalf wrote a book called A Treaty on Agriculture and Practical Husbandry. This was written back in 1786, so 3 years after the Revolutionary War. And that's when Metcalf the spy sent a copy of his book to none other than George Washington, who not only wrote him back, but then tucked the copy away in his library. And of course, he was none the wiser that he had just gotten a book from a spy for the British. And today is the birthday of Frances Ellen Watkins Harper. She was born on this day in 1825. She was an African-American suffragist. She was a social reformer, an abolitionist, a writer, and a poet. Her most famous quote, you may have heard of, is, "We are all bound up together in one great bundle of humanity." Frances's writing was mostly dedicated to her work for justice, but in going through most of it, I found that she occasionally would write about nature. And here's an excerpt from a delightful little poem that she called The Crocuses. And I thought you'd especially enjoy this little verse. It goes like this. Soon a host of lovely flowers from vales and woodland burst, But in all that fair procession, the crocuses were first. Isn't that sweet? And today marks the birthday of Wilson Rawls, the American writer. He was born on this day, September 24th, in 1913. And he has kind of a memorable story. So think about this. Embarrassment caused him to burn his manuscripts so that his fiancée, Sophie, wouldn't see them. But then later on, she found out about that, and she implored him to rewrite one of the five stories that he'd destroyed from memory. And that resulted in his classic 1961 book, Where the Red Fern Grows. Now, the red fern was not a real plant, but it served as the centerpiece of the novel. And in the book, Wilson wrote these words. I had heard the old Indian legend about the red fern, how a little Indian boy and girl were lost in a blizzard and had frozen to death. In the spring, when they were found, a beautiful red fern had grown up between their two bodies. And the story went on to say that only an angel could plant the seeds of a red fern and that they never died. Where one grew, that spot was sacred. It's time for today's Unearthed Words. Oh, today's Unearthed Words are from one of my favorite garden authors. This is Lucy Maud Montgomery's Rainbow Valley, which is part of her Anne of Green Gables series. Here's an excerpt. There were several things concerning which Miss Cornelia wished to unburden her soul. The funeral had to be talked over, of course. Susan and Miss Cornelia thrashed this out between them. Anne took no part or delight in such ghoulish conversations. She sat a little apart and watched the autumnal flame of dahlias in the garden and the dreaming, glamorous harbor of the September sunset. Mary Vance sat beside her, knitting meekly. Mary's heart was down in the Rainbow Valley, whence came sweet, distant softened sounds of children's laughter, but her fingers were under Miss Cornelia's eye. She had to knit so many rounds of her stocking before she might go to the valley. Mary knit and held her tongue, but used her ears. I never saw such a nicer looking corpse, said Miss Cornelia judicially. Myra Murray was always a pretty woman. She was a Cory. It's time to grow that garden library with today's book, Welcome to the Farm by Shay Elliott. This book came out in 2017, and the subtitle is How to Wisdom from the Elliott Homestead. Well, Shay lives with her family in the Pacific Northwest, and she's the founder of the blog The Elliott Homestead, and you should really check it out if you haven't yet. Shay is a beekeeper, a gardener, and she enjoys preserving a variety of foods for the winter larder. This book is truly a welcome to the Elliott Farm, and Shay shares everything she's gleaned about growing good food right in her own backyard. Shay teaches a ton in this book, how to harvest organic produce, how to plant an orchard, build a greenhouse. She talks about winter sowing and growing, making cider and wine, how to can jams and jellies, if you're interested in that, raising chickens and bees, and even how to milk a dairy cow and make your own butter. So there you go. This book is 336 pages of jam-packed goodness, no pun intended, from a mini farm that will help homesteaders and urban farmers alike. You can get a copy of Welcome to the Farm by Shay Elliott and support the show using the Amazon link in today's show notes for around $10. And it's a great book. Finally, here's something sweet to revive the little botanic spark in your heart. It was on this day, September 24th, back in 1980, although it seems like it could have been written a long time before that, Minnie Hite Moody wrote in her garden column about her bouquet made of weeds. And I just thought this was a fun way to send you off into the weekend. Minnie wrote, "Somehow or other, I failed to get any flower seeds planted this past summer. June brought its plague of groundhogs. July was here before I had caught up with myself. And then came the storms and rain. It was even too wet for me to go seeking Queen Anne's lace and daisies in the fringes of the golf course. So all through July and August, I had to skirmish for enough blooms to enliven what in the deep South is spoken of as the eating table. I am used to flowers on the table, and while I receive more than my share of elegant hothouse flowers, they do not suit Grandma's plain white ash table with which she went to housekeeping in 1872. September, however, kindly improved my situation. Along my property frontage, where the Ohio Electric Railroad tracks predated the WPA sidewalk, the pale lavender blooms of soapwort, commonly called Pretty Betty, began to peep out. Now, soapwort, which the books call saponaria, a genus of hardy annual and perennial old world herbs of the pink family, is regarded as just an old weed and not very special. Believe me, it was special in our great-grandmother's day, for bar soap and detergents were far in the future, unless she made her own soap with grease and lye. I tried washing with soapwort myself one time, just to see how it worked, and was pleasantly surprised. By themselves, they don't make an especially stunning bouquet, so it's fortunate that ironweed blooms at the same time of year. Ironweed blossoms are purple, and I know garden club ladies who would swoon at the sight of the bouquet right now gracing my eating table, for it has purple ironweed, Pretty Betty of a questionable shade, maybe blue, maybe lavender, along with some bright yellow rudbeckia blossoms and a spray or two of Eupatorium perfoliatum, which is acceptable by that name, but not as plain old good-for-nothing boneset. As a matter of fact, boneset used to ease aches and pains fully as well as some of the costly arthritis and rheumatism pills of the present. All the old wife of bygone days had to do was gather the herb when the bloom was brightest, tie it into a bunch, and hang it from the ceiling beams. The late Yule Gibbons, in his books, claimed that he simply laid boneset for drying on newspapers placed on his attic floor. When the boneset is thoroughly dry, stalks and stems are discarded, and the dried leaves crumbled into airtight jars. And if you don't need boneset tea for rheumatic ailments, it is said to be good for fevers, colds, catarrh, dropsy, general debility, dyspepsia, and trouble arising from intemperance. In other words, hangover. And rudbeckia is that golden September bloom named in honor of Swedish botanist Olaus Rudbeck. Have a great weekend, you guys. Thanks for listening to The Daily Gardener. And remember, for a happy, healthy life, garden every day. The Daily Gardener is produced in lovely Maple Grove in Wyoming, Minnesota. If you want to read today's show notes, just head on over to thedailygardener.org. And while you're there, be sure to sign up for my free Friday newsletter. And don't forget that you have a standing invitation to join the free Facebook group for listeners of the show. Just search for Daily Gardener Community the next time you're on Facebook and request to join. Last but not least, you can always get in touch by emailing me at jennifer@thedailygardener.org. I'm your host, Jennifer Ebling, and as always, have a great day in the garden, and we'll see you on Monday.